got two handouts, a problem set, and another handout, this will probably be our last face-to-face lecture for a while. So things are definitely going to be changing. I don't know quite what that's going to look like. I'm going to start redesigning things. I've got some ideas. I'm going to start redesigning the course this weekend. And then I'm meeting with my TAs on Monday. And then we're going to incorporate a lot of stuff into that. And so the final decision what the course is going to look like will be made on Wednesday, and I'll let everyone know on that, okay? As far as the exam scores, I do not know what the average of that exam is. I haven't had the time to actually look. The last exam score that I recorded and graded was around 11:30 last night. So I'm working on a minimum here. Of course, I'm always working on a minimum. So just be patient. Exam regrades, they're going to be due March 27th. That's a long ways off, okay? So I don't want any regrade requests sent until Monday at the earliest, because I've got a few other things I need to take care of. Okay, so, but know that we are going to try to make the best out of this situation as possible. And we will make it the best experience we possibly can and help you out. And that means changing the way we do business, and we will figure it out. So now we got the two handouts, the packet. I ran into a problem with my previous lecture that there's so much I want to talk about in so little time that it all got jumbled up. So can't talk about everything I want to talk about today. I've got to limit myself. So we'll just cover all the reactions in this purple packet. No, I'm kidding about that. The purple packet represents all the reactions we're likely to cover this semester. I usually hand out a packet this large midway through, but since we aren't going to be meeting midway through, here it is. Okay. Not all of these are going to be on the next exam, okay? Not all of these will be on the final, it just depends on what we get through. So I just wanted to get these out there for those of you that could make it to lecture today, so you don't have to print it out later. Okay. And this will be available on Canvas as well. All right, so what do I want to start with? Let's see here. First things first. A lot of the lectures are going to be translated to online. Lectures. And so one thing that you can do online that you can't do during lecture is to actually pause it. And so there will be points during these videos in which you want to pause and drink. I meant pause to think about things. Not the other word that rhymes with drink. It's think. You want to pause and think about things. That's what I meant. Okay. So an example of that might be, say, how would you make this compound right here? Molecules containing 4 carbons or less. No, actually 6 carbons or less. So this would be pause point. Well, this case, you want to think about how we make compounds. And we're going to start to do something called retrosynthetic analysis. Yeah, big term. All it means is work backwards. Think about it in terms of archery. If you were going to hit that target, where should you stand? Not over here. Stand over there, you're more likely to shoot yourself in the foot. What you want to do is stand right here, right next to the target, if you're going to hit the target. Okay? So you don't think about what you're going to start with. You think about the product and think about what reaction is necessary to make just that product. And alkyne synthesis, we briefly went over this on Monday, we make by SN2 reactions. Okay? And we are going to make the carbon-carbon bond next to that alkyne. Okay? So we have two possibilities of carbon-carbon bonds. We have possibility A, and we have possibility B. So here is probability where you want to pause this video and draw out the two possibilities. I got my Dr. Pepper. I can wait. Okay, so possibility A, we're splitting that bond right there. Be like that.
Now, in order to do an SN2 reaction, you need a good nucleophile and you need a good leaving group. Okay? So, what's a good nucleophile? Or how are we going to change? What side needs to have the good nucleophile? The left side or the right side? The right side, that's the sp hybridized carbon. That becomes your nucleophile.
And the way you draw that as a nucleophile, you can draw it as a lone pair. Or you can draw it as a bond to a sodium. Although that's not really a bond. It's more of an ionic compound than an actual covalent compound. But either one of those is acceptable for your nucleophile. Your leaving group, you need to still add a leaving group, and that goes on the other carbon. And you can choose
multiple possibilities of leaving groups. Okay. So far, so good. That's one possibility.
blue possibility. Would be this, paying close attention to the alpha carbon, we have to make sure that we invert it. So, that's the two possibilities. Which one is better? The red one or the blue one? Or are they both equally okay? How many say red? How many say blue? Good, no one's raising their hand with blue. The red one, that's a good one. This has to do with what's constantly competing with the SN2 reaction. Anyone? E2. Yeah. E2 reaction. And the secondary site likes to do SN1, SN2, E1, E2. This is a strong base, so it can do E2. It's a good nucleophile, so we can do SN2. This case right here gives significant amount of E2 products. Top one, on the other hand, the base still can do SN2 because it's a good nucleophile, can do E2 because it's a strong base, but the alpha carbon here is primary, more likely to do SN2. So the red one is the better option, okay? Now, we've talked about making these sodium species, but if you don't remember how to do that, it's not a big deal, because it is actually the very first reaction that we learned. The way we make those is by adding NaNH2. To alkynes. And by the way, since our product is optically active, our starting materials, that starting material must be optically active. All this is an acid-base reaction. Okay.
Now, I know that you have been conditioned in general chemistry and so far in this class of thinking starting materials on the left, products on the right. Time to break out of that mold. The products can be up, they can be down, they can be left, they can be to the right in these synthesis type problems. Okay? So, what's very, very, very important is that from now on, when you're doing synthesis type problems, you draw one irreversible error. Okay?
Doesn't matter if a reaction is reversible or not. You just draw one irreversible arrow that's always pointing from starting material to product of a step. And pay very close attention to that arrow. I'll show you the direction of the steps. Okay? Yeah, you can no longer assume that if it's a molecule on the left, it's the starting material. No. So watch out for that. Because organic chemistry wasn't hard enough. All right. But that is essentially how we are going to make alkynes going on in this class, is we're going to start off with a terminal alkyne. Sort of a pattern. We're going to deprotonate it. And then we're going to react this with an SN2 electrophile. I'll just throw a TS in there, an OTS group. And we're going to use that reaction again and again. Okay? Because this is our carbon-carbon bond-forming reaction. Once we have our alkyne, we're going to use those alkynes to make a vast variety of other molecules. This is sort of our initial stepping stone. From alkynes, you can make alkenes. First one is hydrogen gas, H2, and the second word is called linmars. Linmars is a specialized catalyst, and what it specializes in doing is it adds two hydrogens, cis to each other, on an alkyne. If the hydrogens end up cis to each other, this is what's called a syn addition.
And that gives you a cis alkene. The other reaction you can do is what's called a dissolving metal. Where ammonia, NH3, is the solvent.
Okay. To do is you take liquid ammonia, and liquid ammonia, you have to cool it down to get ammonia into the liquid state. Get nice and cold, and you get this sea of ammonia. And you add in lithium metal to it, and the solution turns blue.
This is what's called a dissolving metal reaction, because you're dissolving the lithium metal in the ammonia. And this gives you a transalkene and gives you an anti-addition of two H's.
The mechanism of the dissolving metal reaction, it's a mechanism that you should know, but we're not going to talk about it yet. It involves an intermediate
called a radical. And there are going to be other radical reactions that are more straightforward to explain first. So we're not going to worry about the mechanism of this one yet. H2 and Lenlars, we're never going to worry about that mechanism. It just adds the two hydrogens. Okay. Any questions about this? Yes, does it matter which one you add first? What you'll do, it all happens in the same step. They all have to be together at once. So there is no one and then two on that step. When you're dealing with the above reaction right here, these are separate steps. So you would have first one step, then the second step in the alkyne forming. But when you're reducing an alkyne to an alkene, you have those together at once. Okay? Question? All right. So, now, we have made alkenes in the past by elimination. This one is more controlled, because the alkene up here is where the alkyne was, right? The other thing is, here you get the possibility of two diastereomers. You get to pick which diastereomer you want based off of the conditions that you use. So far, so good? Okay. Now, the E2 reaction can give you one diastereomer, right? But the E2 reaction won't let you predominantly give you a di substitute one. There's no way with the E2 to get just singly one of those two. Okay? But the anti-coplanar rule would give you both products because you have two hydrogens. So this is a much more effective way of making alkenes. One quick note, and it's something that I will have to talk about later. And also, the H2 can go above the arrow or below the arrow. Lenlars can go above the arrow or below the arrow.
If you need to make a terminal alkene,
use H2 and Lindmarks.
The dissolving metal reactions. And by the way, there are two dissolving metal reactions, lithium or sodium. They are interchangeable in this reaction. The dissolving metal reactions do not work well on terminal alkynes. Okay? Now, I've used the term terminal alkene and terminal alkyne. What a terminal alkyne is an alkyne at the end of the molecule. It's an alkyne attached to a hydrogen. Okay? That molecule is a terminal alkyne. This molecule is not a terminal alkyne. See the subtle difference? And the difference is terminal alkynes have a hydrogen attached. And that's the reason why lithium ammonia or sodium ammonia do not work. But again, that's the mechanism, and we'll handle that mechanism in about a week. Actually, no, spring break, so 2.5 weeks. Okay. Any questions so far? Okay. So, keep going. H2 and Lindmarks gives cis alkenes. Lindmarks is sometimes referred to as poison palladium, because what they do is they take, to make Lindmarks catalyst, is they take palladium and then throw some contaminants into that palladium to weaken it. Those contaminants can be quinoline or barium carbonate. There's lots of things you can add to the palladium to poison it. The reason that we need to do such an awful thing to palladium to poison it is palladium is a very, very good metal at reducing alkenes. If you add hydrogen and then palladium on carbon to an alkyne. Now it's palladium on carbon because palladium is expensive, and palladium is very, very reactive. You only need just 0.1 or 0.01 mole percent, meaning for every 1,000 molecules of an alkyne you have, you maybe need 1 or 2 molecules of palladium to reduce it. It's a catalyst. Okay? Now, it's very difficult to weigh out such small amounts. And so, as a result, we often will cut the palladium with carbon. So, activated charcoal, sort of like flour and cocaine or something like that. And it makes it much easier to weigh it out, and they basically sell this palladium on carbon. If you don't include the carbon, no big deal. But oftentimes it's going to be palladium on carbon. Where was I? Oh, yeah. It will take an alkyne and send it all the way down to an alkene. It does not stop at the alkene. It keeps going right through the alkene. It goes right to the alkene. It looks like all we are doing is we're erasing pi bonds. But we're not. We're adding 4 hydrogens. And where a lot of people make mistakes in organic chemistry is they forget about the hydrogens. It's one of the first things we teach you how to do is figure out where the hydrogens are. Don't forget. Carbon makes 4 bonds. If you don't see 4 bonds there, there's hydrogens to make up the difference. Okay? And so this, in a way, gives us another reaction. If we were to have an alkene, that with hydrogen and palladium on carbon and reduce it down to the alkene. Oh, why is that not 6? Good question. Hydrogen and palladium on carbon adds hydrogen 6. Okay? See? So add 6, right? Okay. What's the relationship between these molecules?
They're the same.
What you're about to figure, I'm sure some of you have already figured this out. I am very good at drawing molecules in an unhelpful manner. Okay? So, remember, hydrogens are still added cis, but you're making an alkane, you have complete rotation about that bond. Okay. So
let's make them so that they're not the same.
And to really see that, we're going to use heavy hydrogen. We're going to use deuterium. Okay? So far, so good.
Well, if you do that, the way to predict the products of this reaction when you're adding them syn to each other, okay, we're adding two deuterium syn across that alkene. What you start out by doing is drawing the molecule as it is, except you don't draw in the pi bond. Okay? So far, so good. And down below, do it like this. And I'm just going to erase this for a bit, man, because I had an idea. And I twisted. Okay. We take this molecule. Now you choose one of the sides and you add a deuterium to it. So since the line's going down, we put the deuterium towards the top of the page. Here the line's going up, so we put the deuterium towards the bottom of the page. Right?
And you choose a stereochemistry for a deuterium. Wedge or dash?
Wedge. Excellent. And then this deuterium gets the same treatment.
You chose dashes?
That's just fine.
Okay. Now, everyone's dreaded question, what's the relationship between those two molecules? How many say that they're the same? Okay, how many say they're constitutional isomers? How many say they're diastereomers? How many say they are enantiomers? They are indeed enantiomers.
Our chiral center. This one here is an R chiral center, S and S. So
since they are enantiomers, you draw one of them. Doesn't matter which one you draw.
Draw this one, and you write racemic.
We have gone from achiral to chiral, and whenever you go achiral to chiral, you get a racemic mixture. Okay, so far? All good? All right. What's the product of the second one?
All right, ready? All right, let's see how good you guys did. Did you get that? No? That's the right answer, though. Did you get this? Those are the same molecule. Which one am I going to give you on the exam? Exactly. So what you'll need to recognize is, okay, we have one way of adding two deuterium to make an alkane, and that's D2 and palladium on carbon. D2 on palladium on carbon adds things syn to each other, right? So what you'll need to do, if I give you this product, is you need to realize that you need to redraw that molecule so the deuteriums are syn to each other, cis to each other, okay? And so one way of doing that is drawing the deuteriums as both lines, heading to the top of the page. Okay? And if you take a look at that, that makes this methyl group a wedge, and that makes this methyl group, let's see here, that goes to there, also a wedge. Now the deuteriums are syn to each other. So far, so good? The methyl groups are wedges. Wedges end up cis to each other. You see how we work backwards from that? It's a matter of redrawing the molecule. So the deuteriums are syn to each other. And when you do that, you see the methyl groups are both wedges. So that means they started out cis to each other on the alkene. Okay? So far? Now, there's nothing I can really do to make the synthesis of these alkenes tricky. That's a transalkene. Transalkenes come from lithium and ammonia. Cisalkenes come from hydrogen and linars.
Okay, so far? All right.
Now, we can make cisalkenes or transalkenes from the alkynes. Alkynes we make by SN2. Okay? See how we sort of rid that? Now we can make a wide variety of alkenes. The rest of the semester is going to be looking at what we can do with alkenes and how alkenes react. And we already have a reaction underneath our belts of alkenes.
order to do that reaction, what goes above the arrow?
You said it right away. Sulfuric acid. The other product that you get in this reaction is water. What's the name of this reaction? E1. Okay. E1 reactions, are they reversible or irreversible?
Reversible.
They're reversible. There's our reaction with of an alkene. Since the E1 reaction is reversible, we can take that alkene and add a catalytic amount of sulfuric acid to it and a lot of water. Go there. Okay, so far. All right. The mechanism of this is the mechanism of the E1 reaction, except in reverse. So we'll have just enough time to do this. Problem is, this alkene has two carbons. The last step in the E1 reaction is you take the proton off. So the first step in going backwards is you put the proton back on. But you can put the proton back on, you have two possibilities of where that proton goes. It can go to the left, or it can go to the right. Goes to the left, the carbocation ends up there. If it goes to the right, carbocation ends up to the right, on the left. Which side is favorable? The top one or the bottom one? The bottom one here. Always protonate to form the most stable carbocation. This is what's referred to as Markovnikov addition. And then to finish up the reaction, nucleophile adds. To the carbocation, and then you have something take the hydrogen off, get the product. The name of this reaction is an addition reaction to an alkene. All it is just the reverse of the E1 reaction.
And we are out of time. So we will continue this online, I guess. And we'll see what happens. Have a good spring break.